anxious about earthly things, but to love things heavenly. And even now, while we are placed among things that are passing away, to hold fast to those that shall endure. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Amos. Hear this, you that trample on the needy and bring to ruin the poor of the land, saying, when will the new moon be over so that we may sell grain, and the Sabbath so that we may offer wheat for sale? We will make the ephah small and the shekel great, and practice deceit with false balances, buying the poor for silver and the needy for a pair of sandals, and selling the sweepings of the wheat. The Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob, surely I will never forget their deeds. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 113. Hallelujah, give praise, you servants of the Lord.
Praise the name of the Lord.
Let the name of the Lord be blessed
from this time forth forevermore.
From the rising of the sun to its going down,
let the name of the Lord be praised.
The Lord is high above all nations, and his glory above the heavens.
Who is like the Lord our God,
who sits enthroned on high,
but stoops to behold the heavens and the earth?
He takes up the wheat out of the dust,
and lifts up the poor from the ashes.
He sets them in princes,
with the princes of his people.
He makes the woman of a childless house
to be a joyful mother of children.
A reading from the first letter of Paul to Timothy. First of all, I urge that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgivings be made for everyone, for kings and all who are in high positions, so that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and dignity. This is right and is acceptable in the sight of God, our Savior, who desires everyone to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God. There is also one mediator between God and humankind, Jesus Christ, himself human, who gave himself a ransom for all. This was attested at the right time. For this I was appointed a herald and an apostle. I am telling the truth. I am not lying. A teacher of the Gentiles in faith and truth. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said to the disciples, there was a rich man who had a manager, and charges were brought to him that this man was squandering his property. So he summoned him and said to him, what is this I hear about you? Give me an accounting of your management, because you cannot be my manager any longer. Then the manager said to himself, what will I do now that my master is taking the position away from me? I'm not strong enough to dig, and and I'm ashamed to beg. I have decided what to do so that when I am dismissed as manager, people will welcome me into their homes. So summoning his master's debtors one by one, he asked the first, "How much do you owe my master?" He answered, 100 jugs of olive oil. He said to him, "Take your bill. Sit down quickly. Make it 50. Then he asked another, "And how much do you owe?" He replied, 100 containers of wheat. He said to him, "Take your bill and make it 80. And his master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly. For the children of this age are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than are the children of the light. And I tell you, make friends for yourselves by means of dishonest wealth so that when it is gone, they may welcome you into the eternal homes. Whoever is faithful in very little is faithful also in much. And whoever is dishonest in very little is dishonest also in much. If then you have not been faithful with the dishonest wealth, who will entrust you to the true riches? And if you've not been faithful with what belongs to another, who will give you what is your own? No slave can serve two masters, for a slave will either hate the one and love the other, or be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth." The Gospel of the Lord. I'm so glad to see you all. Thank you for coming. And thank you for not leaving after you heard the lessons that we hear this morning. Very curious how the preaching rota got put together. And I've also already heard condolences from members of the men's Bible study about, "Oh, we feel so bad for you, Heath." It's funny though, isn't it? First of all, let me just say, Amos, in a bad mood, always, most of the time in that book, because he's living in a time when very few have a lot and a whole bunch don't have anything, where there is power is out of balance, where people care more about the management system than they do about human beings. Sounds like today, doesn't it? So God invites Amos to go and tell everybody to quit it and to live a new way. So you can read the book of Amos when you go home if you want to. But I think Luke, oddly enough, in this quirky little parable, invites us to experience a new way of living that takes this unjust way of life and makes it well, and makes it, as in heaven, so on earth. So bear with me as I try to unpack this. I spend a lot of time reading different scholars, and I think you'll find it funny that one person said, "Just don't talk about this parable and talk about other things in the lesson." It's like, okay, but it's still in the Bible. Like, we still have to deal with it someday. But most scholars refer to it as the hardest parable. And it is in some ways, because it sounds like, and remember, this isn't Jesus pointing out, "Hey, you guys, look at this master and this manager." Jesus makes up this story. And it sounds like he's making up a story where it's okay to be immoral. It's okay to be unjust. It's okay to not be honest with your boss or someone in charge of you. But I think Jesus is actually saying something different. Think about this. First of all, this lesson comes right after we hear the prodigal son or the loving father story. Great parable. So wish that was what we were hearing today. Isn't that a wonderful one? I mean, everybody loves that parable, or most people do anyway. And I imagine that when the people following Jesus heard it for the first time, they must have thought, "Tell it again. Tell it again. That's the best story. This guy completely blows it. And what does his father do? He loves him. He pours grace and forgiveness and joy and brings him home. It's this wonderful story right after the lost coin and the lost sheep and all those. Oh, it's so great. So they're just still, their ears are still ringing, their hearts are still happy when they hear that story. And then we hear this one. But it's kind of like the prodigal son, actually. Here's one clue. Jesus says, there once was a manager who was squandering, or accused anyway, of squandering his master's money. Same word that's used about the son when he's squandering his living in the faraway country. So maybe Jesus' hearers of this story are thinking, ooh, it's going to be another one of those great ones. Let's pay attention. What's also similar about these stories is that the son in the prodigal son story, remember, he finds that he's about to die. He can't take care of himself. Remember, he's now living on the farm and he's eating from the pig's food. He's basically found that he's dead. He cannot survive. Same with this manager. Remember what he says? Okay, if he fires me, I have no place, I have no job. And I'm not strong enough to do construction, and I can't beg, so I'm dead. What am I going to do? And in this story, Jesus introduces, or maybe he highlights, a really important part of what it means to live as people of the kingdom, of what it means to have as in heaven, so on earth, and that is relationship. The manager figures out, you know what I have to do to survive? I've got to go talk to all these other people. I can't do it by myself. I've got to go get in relationship with them so that they will help me survive. And he does. He goes and says to the people in debt, cut your debt in half. Take it off by a fifth. And he begins to be in right relationship with them. Imagine the humility it must have taken for this guy to do that. Imagine what it must have been like. Yes, he must have realized I am dead to an old way of living. And the only way I'm going to survive is being in relationship with these people around me. And then look what happens. Everybody else in the parable dies and rises as well. And the parable begins to be a story about God's grace and about how forgiveness comes about through resurrection from the dead. The unjust manager is forgiving all these debts. He's rising to a new way of life himself, now being in relationship with these people, not dominating them. And now they too get to be in relationship with him and the master. Suddenly, I can imagine the people in debt are no longer afraid, are no longer weighed down. I don't know about you all, I can't stand to be in debt. It's awful. And so imagine the relief, the awe, the surprise they felt when this guy is saying, cut it in half, take it off by a fifth. I wonder what it did to them. I wonder if they were brave enough, curious enough to accept it. Or do they walk around scratching their heads, is this guy for real? But it seems the way Jesus tells the story that suddenly they are liberated and they are no longer oppressed. This way of life is dead and now they get to be in relationship. And then the funniest part of all to me, the master who in verse 2 fires the manager, you're out. He doesn't even give him a trial. Did you notice that? He just hears that he's squandering and believes it. Doesn't even check it out. Just brings him in. It's what I hear about you, you're gone. And then by verse 8, he's saying, oh, look at you. Look at what you've done. This is amazing. I can't believe it. Almost as if I've been living my life backwards all this time. The master, too, is invited to end a way of life that is not serving him, that's keeping him isolated from other people. And how wonderful that he recognizes the new relationships happening among the people around him, and he wants to be a part of that too. As in heaven, so on earth. being children of the kingdom is about being in relationship. It's not about a system where a few people have a lot and a lot of people have nothing. It's not about justice that comes about by a system that keeps people oppressed or feeds people's egos by thinking that they're more powerful than they really are. It's not like that. And Amos is right to be in a bad mood about it when we think the kingdom is like that. But Jesus today says, no, as in heaven, so on earth, everyone is in right relationship with themselves, with God, with one another. Author and priest Robert Capon even went so far as to say, how about we look at the fact that Jesus himself might, that the manager himself might even be the Christ figure in the story? Think about that. This unjust manager becomes the Christ figure? But it's true. He dies and rises, and in his forgiving and dying and rising, everybody around him is as well. Is he unjust? Sure, by the ways of the world, but so was Jesus, wasn't he? I mean, think about it. He wasn't a very popular guy. I mean, some folks followed him around, but then they would leave after a while because he said strange things and he didn't act right. He didn't follow the religious laws of his time. He talked to women. He had dinner with crooks and sinners. And he even died because people misunderstood him as a criminal. Well, thank God. Thank God he didn't follow the ways of the world's sense of justice. And he followed the ways of the kingdom. Always, over and over and over again in his ministry, telling stories, giving examples of how, as in heaven, so on earth, is possible in our relationships with one another, in our humbling ourselves to forgive, to die, and to rise to a new way of life. Thank you for coming here today. I'm so glad to see you. And I ask you, what is it? What's gotten in the way that you can't experience that grace, the forgiving, healing, resurrected life that God is so dying, has died to give us? Whatever it is, leave it here and go out and live. Amen. Let us pray.
Father, we pray for the Holy Catholic Church.
May all be one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you. We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake. Have compassion of those who suffer from any grief or trouble. Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for the saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others. We remember those on our parish prayer list, especially those from our parish. Mary, Elizabeth, Clara, Margot, Casey, Christopher, Robin, also Donna, Dylan, Arden, Sam, Laura, David, Don, Nancy, and Barb, Gwen, Marty, Cindy, John, Frank, Marilyn, Andrew, John, Luis, and Betsy, Megan, Jill, Jim, Nancy, Peter, Bill, Christian, and Roger. We give thanks for those having birthdays today, Barbie Payne and Jeffrey Powell, and for others, blessings. Remember those who have died, especially Aline Wigington in our parish cycle of prayer, and for Dorothy Dawson, Dale Burrell, and Donnie Myers, for whom the altar flowers have been given. We remember Care for Friends, one of the outreach ministries this parish supports.
God, his blessed Son, made himself known to his disciples in the breaking of bread. Open the eyes of our faith, that we may behold him in all his redeeming work, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
And joy be with all on this increasingly lovely morning, and especially welcome to new friends and visitors who are here today, and old friends who are back, perhaps after some time away. I want to make a special welcome, offer a special welcome to our guest organist and conductor today, Royce Eckert. Derek is playing the dedicatory recital on a new organ in Columbus, Ohio, and Royce is here today for the first time in 10 or 12 years, probably, back at Holy Comforter, an experienced old pro in the Chicago area. It's a delight to have him here, as it says in the bulletin. He's not only an organist and conductor, he's also a composer and arranger and a prominent figure in the area of hymnology, of editing hymnals, which is a rare and unique gift. So thank you for being here today, Roy. Also want to remind everybody, just the women. So men, don't listen for a minute, as if that's hard. Tonight is what I'm talking, I mean. Tonight, reminder that at 7 o'clock, the new Women's Bible Study Group will begin here in the library, led and facilitated by Pastor Heath. All women are invited, whatever your background, your familiarity with please know that all are welcome tonight at 7 o'clock in the library. And now, men, do listen, because I want to remind everybody that next week we will begin our foyer groups on the 29th. It's not too late to sign up if you haven't had a chance yet and are hoping to, but I do ask that you do so by tomorrow, because those groups will be put together in just a few days here. Even if you can't, say, make the first gathering, don't worry. We have a few people in that category. We'll still get these up and going. By way of reminder, they're gatherings of 8 to 10 people randomly put together in order to afford the opportunity to get to know people you might not otherwise encounter and engage here at Holy Comforter. So I hope you will consider seriously, if you haven't already signed up, taking part. It's a great chance to become familiar with, friends with, others in the parish family. Also, wanted to remind everybody that right after this Eucharist, Father Chris will lead the adult forum. We will continue and go deeper into our theme of as in heaven, so on earth, focusing on the concept of the universal Christ, as was just testified very briefly last Sunday. So I hope you'll join us down in the great room for the adult forum right after this liturgy. And I also invite you to read the other announcements about Stephen Ministry and about the Compassion Liturgy coming up in a few weeks as you can. Walk in love. As Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Teach me, O Lord, the way of my soul.
share our human nature, to live and to die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. And the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took a cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for all, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you. your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.
Let us go forth to love and serve the Lord.